In 1995, with former three-in-a-row star Bosco McDermott at the helm, Galway won their first Connacht title since 87 and played Tyrone in the semi-final.
Straight to Gavin. Now Alan Mulholland, great ball to Neil Finnegan. Here's a scoring chance. Finnegan bottled up quickly. There's a loose man outside. It was Fergal O'Neill. Does it have the distance? It does. Galway's first point coming then after 7.5 minutes. Fergal Gavin starting this one. Now it's Ray Silk. There should be a point here for Ray Silk to kick. And he puts it over the bar and the sides are level. Looking around, players calling for it, many of them. Jaff Allen now winding himself up for the left-footed kick that sails comfortably over the bar. And Galway lead by 2 points. Jaff Allen, Neil Finnegan. Fergal Gavin back inside to Tommy Wilson. It's a great ball. Lovely football by Galway. Well, the expectations in the West have been huge over the years. Neil Finnegan back to Fergal Gavin, going for the point himself, and that's got over the bar. Fergal Gavin, his first point of the afternoon. Well, here in Croke Park, Stephen Law has got a couple of goals in the past. Here's Val Daly for Galway, back inside towards Finnegan. This is a very purposeful run, and it's over the bar. He's delighted. His fourth point already in this match. Finnegan's kick. Nicely inside. Val Daly shooting, and he's put it over the bar, making amends for the one that he put wide some time ago, right foot or left. Bosco has certainly done a great job. He said, of course, after the Connacht final, they had no chance.
Meanwhile, a number of changes were taking place in Galway football. Club football was getting much stronger in the Connemara region. Carraroe became the first Gaeltacht team to win a County Galway senior title, and more Connemara players were brought in to strengthen the county senior panel.
Rudwan Fin Club Vial, Tanya Enner Dinit, Abatase Colonna Ovi to Nan Shu, Vitan Rolega Scholar, so the Dini machine. So Dimmer to Pelle Hill, Scotu Wile Hill, Svitu Musa, Sir Bobble Hill, I guess Abon Vitrubler Dinawan, who took Kona Road, Mavitrubble Death of Hurahun of it. So Tan Club Marshin Agoni, Tasha Lodge, Crua, Nagantu Fatherless and Kinan Conde, Tasha Crua on the Valach Hain, a forcing on Colonna Wile to Dolla Wile of the Valach Hain. Ach, sa glob bint ugun I loidir.
Vi dim mwyd am was y geid lian ein dygwych, fi mwyd chyd y chwn i'n tos. Agus hos o'r amor, gyn bydd y trwy mewn ffwrdd ffordd lein wedi eisiau. Agus rwgsiad, cynt I rwgsiad o'r nge, beid i'r cer wedi eisiau sy'n dar o le. Sy'n gwrdd am tam y drwbl, ddech sgwrdd Gary MacDonald o ffyr chwl losion. Agus fi Gary I hyn an gwan y cic yn y sir. Clubs like Corrafin adopted more comprehensive underage policies and were rewarded by becoming the first Galway club to win the All-Ireland Championship in 1998.
I always felt a little bit frustrated as a player, especially in the 80s. I always felt that we had plenty of backs, plenty of midfielders. We never had forwards. We never had players capable of taking scores like you need to do to win matches. And I felt my biggest contribution, my best contribution, might be to start with very young players and coach very, very basic skills. And one of those skills would be, you know, the ability to score. Because I felt we had lost out a lot on that as a team in the 80s. And really, that's what happened, really. I just drifted into it more than anything else. And by the end of the decade, there was half the team was made up of some of the younger players that had come through our coaching structure.
So we were lucky in 98 then. We drew Dungiven in the All-Ireland semi-final. Joe Brawley, Brian McGilligan were their stars. And we got to the final then against Erin's Island, 15-10. Jerry Burke got man of the match. He scored three wonderful points. But we won a certain amount of admirers. We were the first Connacht club ever to win the All-Ireland club.
There are gaps developing up front if Ray can avail of the space. Gone past one Erin's Island man. There's a second coming in to challenge. Now spreads it over towards Derek Riley. Pete Murray standing off him. Nice skill by Riley, going back into the challenge. Made it difficult for himself, but what about that for class? Jerry Burke. Corrigan Finn again, have the patience to try and open up this Erin's Isle defence. Trevor Burke getting inside. Shane Conlisk survives the challenge. Here's a good effort by Conlisk, and that's a very good score. Erin's Isle players getting a leg and an arm to it. A difficult shot. That's a great point. An inspirational score by Aidan Donlan. Jerry Burke is there again. Onto the left foot. He scored a moment ago, but this one is... Yes, it is. How could I doubt you, even for a moment, Jerry Burke? 39-year-old Garda, Jerry Burke. Still Shane. Doing well. Calling for it in the centre is Jerry Burke. Trying to get away from his marker. Floating it in towards Eddie Steed. Trying to turn, and in the old-fashioned style, fists it over the bar. The old fellows are great in Corrigan. Yes, indeed, the West is very much awake. Corrigan's Ray Silk accepts the Andy Merrigan.
It had taken the county almost 30 years to produce a club team capable of winning a national competition. That, ironically, was started in Dunmore in the late 60s.
We had the two Donlans. You had John Keenan and Tommy Keenan, your Seamus Leighton and Bosco McDermott were the nucleus of a great team, and we won a good few championships in the 60s, but we felt at the time that the lads that were playing along with them weren't getting the credit they deserved. There were attempts to start a club championship, but it had faltered, and we had a motion in to start the club championship. We got the support all right of our own county board, and we went to the Connacht Council, and the Connacht Council turned us down. I asked them as a last resort, would they allow us to run it ourselves? So Dr. Keenan said from the top of the table, I'll let you run it, but don't come back to us looking for money.
Now, Leinster weren't organised at the time, but Munster seemingly were. And as I remember, Dunmore McHale's played St. Nick's of Cork in the semi-final, and then we played them in the final in September. And Bertie Coleman, I would have to say, was the man that made the All-Ireland Club Championship. He drove it along, and it was sponsored that time by Carl System Buildings, as you can see here on the cup.
We went to Congress with it in 1970. It got through by, I think, 75 votes to 90 or something like that. Went from strength to strength, and now we have 40 or 50,000, and it's probably the second biggest competition in the country.
A number of counties had success with outside managers, and the Galway County Board decided to bring in former Mayo player John O'Mahony to train the teams. The opening game was against Leitrim in Carrigan-Shannon.
Niall Finnegan with Adrian Charles. Terrible ball from a corner forward. There should be a back. It's picked up by Derek Savage, who hooks it in beautifully. Still Pádraig Joyce, still with very few options, except to go it alone. Wonderful fielding by Sean O'Donnell. No question about a foul there. This is a good ball. Chance for Pádraig Joyce. He's pulled, he's dragged, it's saved, it's there again for him. And he lashes it over the bar. Fintan McBride, deep inside his own half of the field, now coming away with it. Good run by McBride, but oh, so beautifully robbed. Paul Clancy.
Come on, Joe, get in there.
Derek Savage fouled. And creeping inside was a Galway man. And here's a chance of a point by Michael Dunlap. Derek Savage. Joseph Tiffany still with him. Again, given a lot of space. Paul Clancy on the turn. And the point results. Tomas Mannion, the cornerback, sends it over the bar. Meanwhile, it's Galway that's going into the attack. Sean Ogdepuer taking off Seamus Quinn. And what Seamus Quinn can do a moment ago, Sean Ogdepuer can do now.
And at the time, I felt that we really needed a shake-up if we were going to go anywhere. And I felt that it was a good time to go for an outside manager outside the county and try and pull the young fellas. There was a lot of young fellas coming through at the time at under 21 and that. And I felt if we could get the old and the new together, that we would be certainly a force or be contenders, if you like. Didn't think we'd win the All-Ireland in 98, I can assure you, but I felt we would certainly be contenders if we got our act together and that. And we brought in John O'Mahony and he brought Pete Warren and Stephen Joyce with them. They were a very good combination and have certainly lasted the test of time, if you like. And have been there for 4 years, have marvellous success. They have contested four All-Ireland finals, winning two, drawing one and losing one. I think it's a great period for Galway football and I think it was a very important move at the time. I know maybe I got a lot of stick for it at the time and people felt that I was overboard going outside the county. I felt it was the right thing to do. I still believe it was the right thing to do and I'm very happy with the results of that decision.
The first approach really from Pat Egan, the chairman of the football board, told me that I was nominated by a number of clubs and would have been interested, and that's basically how it started. And there was an interview held, and I ended up on the job anyway.
I was actually out in Boston in a flat with Decky Meehan. We went out to the Connemara Gaels in the summer of 97, and we heard that he was our manager, and like we were both delighted because we knew, you know, what sort of a reputation he had. And I actually spoke to him, the two of us spoke to him on the phone from the flat, just to say that, you know, we were, you know, ready if he wanted us. We were available for selection for the panel, so it was great.
I knew that there was a lot of talent around, and, you know, I knew the wheel has to go full circle sometime, and I was privileged, along with Pete Warren, Stephen Joyce, and, you know, all the lads involved. It was great to be a part of the success.
Playing it left half forward, getting the ball in low towards Derek Savage. Outside him is Kevin Walsh, decides to find the return ball to Declan Meehan on the right foot, and that's a great point. The breaking ball gathered by Jerry Keane, sent in. Here's a chance for Roscommon. He's going for the goal, and a wonderful save by Martin McNamara. And McNamara had to be at his most agile to deflect it out for a superb 45. Quick ball in that Gay Sheeran was talking about. Dowd had the confidence to take on Martin McNamara, and a great save. Breaking ball at midfield. Lovely skill by Savage. Lovely chip up. Sweet ball in towards Jeff Allen. This is a nice move by Galway. If the finish is there, it is. Charlotte Fallon from one of the most famous clubs in Ireland, Tuam Stars.
John O'Mahony himself rang me up and asked, told me that he had taken on the job as manager and that he was looking for selectors, and that I was one of the first names that came to mind, and he rang me to see if I would join him in the team, and obviously now I'm thrilled that I did, and it has been a very successful 4 years.
Kevin Walsh and Jerry Keane, and he gives the free, Seamus Pryor, that is, the referee, to Galway. John Dibbley trying to feed Jeff Fallon, who's left unmarked in a bit of space, tries to get by Clifford McDonald, takes a shot, and that is going over the bar. Jerry Keane can't get there ahead of Kevin Walsh. Great catch by him to Jeff Fallon. And there's a certain amount of panic in this Galway attack, but they find the target. But a great point by Jeff Fallon. At the moment, he gave the thumbs up to his manager. Meanwhile, it's Derek Savage cutting through.
and Galway are back in front. Derek Savage failed to score in Tuam, but he's been threatening to score in virtually every game. Remember that great goal against Mayo? Here's a very good point against Roscommon. Kevin Walsh taking it quickly. Michael Donlan. Good incisive run by the centre-half forward. Still Donlan. Terrible pass, goes behind instead of in front of Derek Savage. Savage makes the most of it. Well, not quite. Yes, he does. Good point by Derek Savage. Walsh goes forward. Gets by Clifford McDonald rather easily. Jaff Allen is hit shoulder. Ball squelches out of his grasp. Comes to Sean Old to prayer. And that's a point by Sean Old. Damien Donlan trying to keep him out. Finnegan going for the equaliser. His second point of the match. Who can break open their opponent's defence? Porrick Joyce. Going on a lovely crossfield run, which is causing no problems to Roscommon. Now this could, because it's Sean Oak to prayer. Onto the right boot. Hits it high, it's curling. Derek Thompson can do nothing about it. And Sean Oak to prayer scores the point. Just about 20 seconds away from this full-time whistle. Can Roscommon get an equaliser? The referee has blown his whistle for a jersey pull just inside the Galway 45 metre line. We are now into injury time, and from here Eddie Lohan has to score a point to level the match and force the game in this Connacht final replay into extra time. Eddie Lohan has the hopes of every Roscommon man. His fifth has to go over to give Galway and Roscommon a chance to play extra time. The white flag is raised, the sides are level in Dr. Hunt. Porrick Joyce twisting, trying to get away from Kieran Heenahan. Back outside to Jaff Allen, a ball for Derek Thompson. Trying to get away, he's robbed, here's a chance, a goal! A goal for Galway, that surely will send them to Croke Park. Derek Thompson obviously took his eye off the ball, he was easily dispossessed. And from a two-point lead, it is now a substantial 1-5. Thompson had the ball collected. Let's see again. As he was attempting to fist it clear, he lost possession. And you can take your pick of two Galway players who rattled the net. John O'Mahony has done it for Mayo. He's done it for Leitrim. And he's done it for the tribesmen.
What a game. What a game. We have a young team. And we have an awful lot of work to do. But I just want to signal, I just want to congratulate our own team, a tremendous, absolutely fantastic character, and Roscommon on a great game, and well done to them.
Ray Silk makes history.
Since 1986, through the good years and the bad, Galway football has been sponsored by Tommy Varden.
I was born in a place called Bishop Street. It was the home of the Immortals, Sean Purcell, Frank Stockwell, Jackie Mangan in 56, Brian Waldron, who won a county minor medal in 52. Brian Mahan lives there, who was the captain of that 52 minor team, and a brother of the illustrious Jack. And Michael Garrett and Mick Rinnans, who played centre field, both for Galway in the 60, in the three in a row era, both lived in Bishop Street, and Mick Garrett still does. It was 1986. I was approached by Mike O'Kelly and Jack Mahan and asked would I be willing to sponsor the club county championship, the senior football county championship. And that was in 1986, and that's when I became involved first, which is 15 years ago. I was humbled, actually, to be quite frank, Mayall, because I thought it was a great honour, because I love Gaelic games, hurling and football, and I was delighted if I could offer a tuppence worth started to keep the flag flying, because you must remember at that particular period Galway football was in the doldrums after the infamous 83 final, and it took it years to recover, and I suppose you could say it never recovered properly until about 95.
Gavin, nice ball inside to Jaff Allen. Fallon galloping through, that the first point from play. Here's Porrick Joyce, now around right half forward, the hand pass inside for Savage to get onto. Tohill, the nearest man. Emmett McKeever trying to keep it away from him. Great block down by Henry Downey. Comes back to Joyce once again. Still Porrick Joyce going through. And he's put it over the bar.
is Sean O'Donnell. Kicking truly, has he got the accuracy? He certainly has. The big man with a wonderful kick late in the half. It's been all Galway. They've been much by far and away the better team. Towards Shea Walsh, the fresh man in. Nice ball inside. Ja Fallon kicking. It's on its way and it's over the bar. Good ball inside towards Ja Fallon. Looking for another one. A Fallon special perhaps. Yes. A third point by Ja. This ball is picked up here. Picked up well by Shea Walsh. On towards Porrick Joyce. Joyce not even thinking about a goal. Happy with the point. His seventh of the match. An excellent scoring performance by Porrick Joyce. Many of them have come from frees, but that from play was a delightful kick. Nice combined play. Dermot Heaney trying to steamroll his through. Inside it goes again. Tohill in there. Can he kick? He's lost it. It's a penalty. A penalty awarded to Derry very late in the match. For a moment there, I thought the ball was about to be carried over the goal line. And it's in! McNamara got a hand to it. But the goal by Gary Coleman coming in the 69th minute.
There was such a barren period from the three in a row in 1966. And Galway were so unfortunate in the 70s and 80s not to win something. Just that lack, last minute efforts or just something funny went wrong on the day. So a number of us got together in the early 90s and we formed a Galway Football Supporters Club. The county board were strapped enough with cash. The management seemed to be strapped enough with cash. And what we wanted to do was that the manager would have a facility to engage in a full 30-man panel. And what was happening was it seems that the GEA and the powers within the GEA were saying 23, we look after 23 after that. So we kind of took it upon ourselves to be a supporters club for the players and that the whole 30 would benefit from the same weekends away that, you know, they wouldn't be making, having to make that tough decision of who the 23 were until All-Ireland Sunday or All-Ireland semi-final day.
It was in the early 90s that I think actually it was Jim Carney and Jack Mahan that mooted it one night after a match. There was such little support going to the matches and we started trying to think ideas how we could get people involved in coming back in and following Galway, as well as the idea of raising money and supporting the team. Originally we had corporate membership coming in, which was very unheard of at that time. Then we started the idea of trying to get more people going to matches. We started the Supporters Club membership, which means people pay £10 and they go into draws for match tickets. At the time when we started in the 90s, we didn't think it would be 10 years before we actually would have been in Croke Park and come back with the cup. And the membership has grown and grown, that we're up to about 500 memberships now. In the early 70s, going to match, you'd see an odd flag, but it wasn't worth talking about. The phenomenon of Tommy Verdon jerseys now, no matter where you can go anywhere around the world. We have people coming in from Hong Kong and Japan and everywhere. And we had the white, what they're calling the training jersey. And they say, no, we want the one the boys wear on television.
Well, it's going to be Tomás Manuro who hit this. Down towards Derek Savage. Crowd roaring on their encouragement, dropping it in there towards Porrick Joyce. Joyce having this chance to put Galway ahead, and he's put it over the bar. First point of the All-Ireland final, scored by Porrick Joyce. Rainbow, Niall Buckley. Big loss in the semi-final. Again, it's Martin Lynch going across there, and Tomás Mannion. They said he might have his hands full this afternoon against the likes of Martin Lynch. He's such a good player. Look how deep Michael Donlan has come. On for Kevin Walsh. A real tearaway play this. That's a great movement. Michael Donlan right through the heart of the Kildare defence. Laying it off here for Derek Savage. Savo playing it outside to Sean Old, the player. And that has gone over the bar. Christy Byrne is objecting. But Sean Old, the player, has come forward and hit an absolutely wonderful point. No real indication of that injury troubling him so far. Played forward by Buckley. Mannion gets it away. This is Sean O'Donnell. Dively Another very good block that time, taking the sting out of that one. Nicely taken up here by Michael Donnellan. He's a terrific footballer, coming forward, looking for another score for Galway. And that's another one. He raises his arms in delight. Michael Donnellan deserved that. It's the second superb run that he's made through the middle. And this one yields a score for the man from Dunmore, MacHales. Well, all the family and all the people in Dunmore would be very pleased to see this. It was a tremendous run forward by Michael Donnellan, and that sailed over the crossbar. Dimley now finally trying to dispossess him. Didwella. O'Donnell's first touch not great, trying to pick that ball up. Gets it the second time. Michael Donnellan again, terrific footballer. Players calling for it. Ja Fallon wants it, gives a return once more to Michael Donnellan, holding up the point of the attack against Anthony Rainbow. The angle tight, the kick good, and it sails over the bar. That's the second point for Michael Donnellan. You just feel of the men I mentioned at the beginning, Donnellan, Fallon and Finnegan, this is the player who is really in form. Ja Fallon against Glen Ryan, he's had some problems getting really good possession in the game. Michael Donnellan, one of the stars so far in this Galway performance. Into the corner he goes. Savage switches wings. You see what I mean about him trying to get it onto the left. Fallon again. Getting this one in, and that's gone over the bar. Ja Fallon, his first point. So he narrows the gap. Kevin Walsh leaving it there. John Dibley was trying to get away from his man, but fouled. That's a great ball. Donnellan inside to a chance. Here's a chance. Galway surely will score here, and they do. Galway have got in front. Paul Joyce with a goal after just 4 minutes of the second half. It was a wonderful sweeping movement. It had pace, penetration and accuracy. But a crucial one this time for Galway. Lovely combined play, marking slack, and Joyce dodged around Christy Byrne. John Dibley here. Now they'll take tremendous encouragement from that score. Down to Joyce, getting away from John Finnegan, playing brilliantly. Again, but this should have been a point. Instead, it ends up in the goalkeeper's arms. Christy Byrne with a bad clearance out to Michael Donnellan. Back towards Neil Finnegan, shouldered by Ken Doyle. He's got support, Fallon's available. Finnegan kicking it, and it's put over the bar. A wonderful spell for Galway. Lovely turn of direction by Kevin Walsh. That's his own 45-metre line. Ja Fallon trying to give the leadership on the 40. Quick throw of the shoulders onto the left boot. A huge one that's high, and it's over the bar. Ja Fallon's second point. Well, this is among the best football that Galway has played in this year's championship. Mick Byrne making the point. He's always been John O'Mahony's support. Christy Byrne kicking straight down the middle. Ja Fallon, his confidence is really sky high at this stage. Out to Michael Donnellan. Ready to take on Anthony Rainbow. And take on he is. His jersey was pulled. The referee seems to allow an advantage. Back towards Finnegan. Can they finish again in some style here? They most certainly can. A second point by Neil Finnegan. And right now it's Galway who look like champions. Linesman Brian White from Wexford just wanting Fallon back into the correct position. The referees and linesmen have been very strict on that in this particular championship. It's a big one. That's a very, very good kick. That's over the bar. This man has the look of a winner. They're convinced. And that's a third point for Ja Fallon. Taken here by Dermot Early. Trying to inspire his colleagues around midfield. Kildare with only 1 point in the second half so far. It's been frustrating for them. Here comes Eddie McCormack. Really leading the charge right into the heart of that Galway defence. The players after him, and McCormack got to it in 20 metres of the Galway goal before being hauled down. This should be a routine kick. Patrick Brennan about to take it. Scored with his first kick since coming on as a sub for Patrick Raven. Corrick Brennan, 2 out of 2 from Freeze. And there Kildare's only scores in the second half. But it's still tight enough and they're still in there with a chance. 4 points between the teams. Two tremendously fit teams who will battle right to the 70th minute and into injury time as well. The prize, the biggest cup, the most famous, most celebrated trophy in Irish sport, the Sam Maguire Cup. Won first of all by Kildare in 1928, but Galway right now ahead by 4 points. Midway through the second half, that's a wonderful catch by Jar Fallon. He's turning on the style here, it's real exhibition stuff by Jar Fallon in the second half. Donnellan ahead there for Kevin Walsh, looking for a next support player who is Sean O'Donnell. That's a good one. That's gone over the bar. O'Donnell did it in the semi-final. He's done it again in the final. Galway fans are celebrating already. Nice ball ahead again from Donnellan to Neil Finnegan. Into the corner to Sean Old, the player. He looks for another point and he's got another. And Galway now are surely the champions. A second point by Sean Old, the player from Antetokounmpo.
Is there no road as it's Mahoos Amora? Marostalon in common low class scale. Karen Sam Maguire, Avrana in captain Volka Magaleva, from Hedor of Zaskashe, Ray Felt.
So Joe McDonough presents Sam to Ray. The West is truly awake. Galway are the All Ireland football champions for 1998. What a day.
Pat Comer, who is a scholar and a gentleman, often said that to win an All-Ireland, it's about history and geography, being in the right place at the right time, and I guess I was.
For me, you know, I suppose the joy on the faces of everybody involved at the final whistle in Croke Park, and it was the last time that the fans were allowed into the pitch in Croke Park. You know, the personal stories around winning with everybody and to see the players, you know, hugging their girlfriends or their wives or their parents or their children or whatever the case may be on the pitch in Croke Park, that's a dream for everybody, and it was realised by all the Galway lads in 98.
I think he has adapted very well, like, you know, and we've accepted him as a Galway man. We're quite happy to do that. He might even get an MEP, like, if he had to run at us. He's certainly in Connacht Ulster between his Leitrim BO and Galway connections. I'm sure, like, an MEP would be.
I suppose they were unlucky, really in the true sense of being unlucky. Missed a penalty in 74. I remember in 76 I was playing myself against Dublin in the semi-final. We lost Joe McLachlan, our free taker, and we missed several frees. We only lost the game by 3 points. So I suppose we were unlucky, but I mean, you just can't live on this all the time. But I suppose we were all delighted in 1998 when the duck was finally broken. And God, we were really delighted this year when we put another one on this wonderful team again.
On the day of that day, Galway, we played bloody well in the first half, and up to half time we were looking good enough, you know, we were 3 points in front. But in the second half, Galway just came out and took over. And they gave an exhibition of football that day, an exhibition of score getting from long distance and all that type of stuff. I think the one that really destroyed them, and I think it dented their confidence quite a lot, was the year that Dublin beat them, you know, when Dublin had 13 men at the end, I think, of that game. And 12 men, is that correct? And they beat Galway. I think that did a lot of damage to Galway football for a long, long time. But the present bunch of men, I think, now have forgotten about all that stuff, I suppose, they hardly remember. Maybe some of them weren't born at that stage. But this is a very good Galway side at the moment.
Comes back towards Tommy Joyce. That's a lovely kick. Beautiful point by Tommy Joyce. Well, what Paulie can do, Tommy can do as well. Martin Lynch, deep again, inside towards Brian Murphy. This time he's got his chance. Still tries to get that goal side. There's a goal! Tight for him. Kildare's first score may have taken 12 minutes to produce. But it's another goal for Tadhg Fenton. Murphy playing it out here. Silk went back goal side. 2 goals in 2 games in the championship. So let's hope we get some decent football. That's taken well. One man who can light up this game. Paul Clancy kicking that one beautifully and has put it over the bar. Nice score by the Moy Cullen forward. Martin Lynch beaten for this one. It's fisted away from him. Coming forward here, Michael Donnellan, what a run. What an exciting player. What a great score. That's his first. Almost worth the admission fee alone to see a player coming rampaging through the opposing defence. Looked confident as that was fisted down by Joe Bergen. Donnellan was anticipating, picking up the pieces. Good solo work, good control, great finish. Hitting it on the run towards Willie McCreary. Bounces away from him. Martin Lynch driving it in there towards Tyke Fennan. This is a good run by Fennan. He's got support. And it's another one, and it's Brian Murphy. A goal for Kildare. 10 minutes into the second half. Great work by the Kildare inside forward line. Delighted Kildare fans. Willing their side through to another All-Ireland final if they can at all. There were a lot of steps taken here. Fennan played it across and Brian Murphy threw himself in after it. Now his positioning inside will be interesting. He was in there after it, first time. Taken up here well by Tomás Meehan. Michael Donnellan standing back, booting it in towards Porrick Joyce. One-handed defending there by the fullback. Joyce has it again. And a lovely kick has gone over the bar. He could be their match winner. He's been in the past so many times. Porrick Joyce with another absolute beauty. Ronan Quinn was not decisive in his covering that time. That was enough. And now there's just 1 point between the teams. And once again, it's the raiding centre-half forward. Michael Donnellan sending it in there. John Finn picking it up, the wing-back for Kildare. Pressure, however. They come again with Derek Savage. Galway. That's a lovely score. Derek Savage putting it over the bar. They're level for the fifth time in this All-Ireland semi-final. Brian Murphy fumbling, needing assistance. Galway kicking it away to Sean O'Dufour. Up it goes towards Paulick Joyce and Derek Savage. Savage has it. Wrestled down. They're trying to get the ball away from him, but Anthony Rainbow has conceded another free kick. The seconds tick away. Looking good for these fans. A minute to go. Michael Donnelly. He's hit it really well, and he's hit it over the bar.
Galway can play well in Croke Park every time they come there, and they're a very, very hard team to beat. You also have players for big days as well. And we had in Kerry some great players on the big days. Just one instance of one man we had in Kerry, Sean Walsh. That man would play a tripe for his club, wouldn't play good football for Kerry. He'd play an outstanding muster final for you, a semi-final, and in an All-Ireland final he would be exceptional. I mean, that's an instance of one player who loved the scene in Croke Park. I mean, he went through the whole lot of that team that I had, the whole 15 of them. They produced it on the day in Croke Park. Galway have players, I think, of that calibre as well at the present time. They always have had them, because Galway have always produced great football in Croke Park over the years. But as I say, that is the real test of a footballer, to produce it on All-Ireland final day in Croke Park.
And Liam Hassett have also changed positions. It's 3:30 on September 24, 2000. The first All-Ireland final of the 21st century is underway, and Galway go into the attack for the first time. Porrick Joyce. Easily cut out, and it's Joyce, the captain again, showing early, and that is going to go harmlessly wide. Paddy O'Shea will be hoping his now very experienced side will settle rather quickly. John O'Mahony will be as always, focused and always with the stopwatch. Aidan McGarrett will push on the back by Sean O'Dupuir. An early ball for Gary Fahey to gain a little bit of confidence. Trying to feed John Divan. It's Tomás Meehan. Ray Silk is available. Thought about using Sean O'Donnell, opted for the long ball instead. Tomás O'Shea. Donald Daly. Down towards Dara Okuneda. Mark McNamara. Little bit unsure, but it works out all right. But look at where Michael Donlan is. Deep inside his own defensive 13-metre line. Ball breaks kindly for Neil Finnegan. Jinking, trying to get away from his opponent, Tom O'Sullivan. Well won back by Aidan McGarrett. Using Dara O'Shea and his midfield partner Donald Daly. Liam Hassett, remember, now operating on the 40. Trying to test out this Galway full back line as quickly as possible. If there's any wind advantage, it favours Kerry in this first half. But it's very, very slight. Mike Frank Russell, scorer of 2 goals and 11 points in the championship so far, gets Kerry underway after 2 minutes and 20 seconds of play.
That's just actually a repeat of what he did against Armagh, the same kind of a score from the same position, and certainly it's a dangerous kind of a precedent for Galway.
Good ball inside, of course, to Mike Frank, showing well, but what confidence in the early moments of an All-Ireland final to actually have a go from there. All-star goalkeeper in 98, Martin McNamara. Sean O'Donnell, magnificent catch. Stopped by Tom O'Sullivan. John Crowley. In towards Mike Frank Russell, given a lot of space by Ray Selk, and the anticipated move of Tomás Meehan over on Mike Frank hasn't materialised so far. It might very quickly as John Crowley adds Kerry's second point. And already there must be a little bit of concern in the Galway dugout about the full back line. Here's this point again by John Crowley, had the space and indeed the confidence. Oh, great catch. And good anticipation by Galway. And again, this time it's Tom O'Sullivan. Dara Okuneda seeking out Aidan McGarrett. John Crowley wanted the knockdown. He got it and he scores. The second point of the match. Came into this game with a total of a goal and 6 points. And certainly beginning to pose problems for Galway and Tomás Meehan. And certainly Kerry's tactics are to send in that ball quickly. Great calling between Aidan McGarrett and Crowley. What about this though for some wonderful football? Donald Daly up into the clouds and down. Brilliant.
And indeed, Marty, one of the things that is noticeable, there's great unease in the Galway full back line when the ball is put in high in among them.
Kick out goes to Noel Kennelly. Mike Frank Russell. Ah, touch of class. The two corner forwards from Kerry, Mike Frank Russell and John Crowley, are unequivocally causing problems for Tomás Meehan and Ray Silk. They've now scored 2 points apiece each. Brilliant ball inside, in front where the forward most desires it, and just turns around, no messing, over the bar.
Galway would hope wouldn't have happened, because bringing in Walsh at this early stage is a bit of a risk on their part, given his fractured season so far.
And Kevin Walsh has the ball. And he's going to do his best now to break the stranglehold that Kerry currently enjoy thanks to Dara O'Shea and Donald Daly. Mike Hassett is over there. He's fouled, so it's going to be quickly taken.
Pressure! 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 And again!
The O'Shea's combining. Liam Hassett into the open space. Hogan stands side. Mike Frank Russell again beating in sheer pace Ray Silk. Dara O'Shea looking at the options. Bit of a cul-de-sac in there, and uses Mike Frank wisely. Kerry's dominance. reflected here with another point, this time by Noel Kennelly. Score of 6 points in the championship, gets his first in the All-Ireland final.
Let's again marvel at the quality of the pass there from Michael Frank Russell, who got far too much room to execute that pass. But again, that must be a great shot in the arm for Noel Kennelly, who possibly struggled in the two games against Armagh and was considered by many unlucky to have got his place today.
And John O'Mahony must be also concerned that his two cornerbacks, Tomás Meehan and Ray Silk, are under severe pressure. So they have to break the stranglehold, because here come more green and gold jerseys. Liam Hassett thought about taking a shot, thought about it a second time, and did it. The original full forward line for Kerry, that was supposed to line out, have now all scored. Mike Frank Russell, Liam Hassett, and John Crowley. Five of the six forwards have now scored. Liam Hassett thought earlier about having a go, decided wisely to balance himself properly, and then easily over the bar.
And indeed, speaking about Liam Hassett, he's getting far too much room to execute moves from the centre half forward position. He's drifting back into the middle of the park, picking up a load of breaks, and it's just at the moment a procession towards the goal.
Question is, Martin Carney, what can Galway do?
Certainly they've got the up the tempo throughout the field. They seem to be in a daze at the moment. They haven't got the tempo of the game at all.
Paul Clancy in the thick of the action comes up with the ball. So anxious to be part of this starting Galway 15. Seamus Moynihan beats Paulie Joyce, employs Dara O'Shea. That gives it to younger brother Tomás, Aidan McGarrett. The Gaeltacht boys combining nicely. Mike Frank Russell giving it to Tomás O'Shea. There's more problems there, and the pass was just a little bit too strong and too behind John Crowley. But it's very messy defending by Galway. Martin McNamara also had to come out, but it is in fact a free to the Connacht champions, a free out.
Yes, indeed, that pass was like an exocet. If that had been properly executed, it was a great chance of a score from Crowley.
What a great run here by Tomás O'Shea, but the pass just off his left shoulder and Crowley could do nothing about it. Kick out by Martin McNamara. Little or no options, there's no running by his half-backs, so he literally has to pump the ball down the middle. Eamon Fitzmaurice. Oh, that's a sweet ball to Mike Frank Russell. Dara O'Kaneda looping this one in. Dively trying to get it just a boot to it as Galway seem to struggle more and more. Hassett goes for a second point. The statistics change. Mike Frank Russell has scored two. Liam Hassett has two. John Crowley has two. Kerry are certainly unsung.
Very much so, and this is the potential to become an embarrassment for Galway unless they get scores very, very quickly to actually develop their confidence.
Liam Hassett finishing this for his second point. Kevin Walsh battling with Donald Daly, and Walsh shows his strength and his determination. Paul Joyce gets away for the very first time. Joyce leading his team by example. Every chance he gets, he's causing problems. And he's fouled in front of the goalpost, so it's another chance for a point for Galway. But they're struggling, really.
Very much so, and it's probably noticeable that Michael Donnan hasn't really got into the game apart from the first couple of minutes, and the supply simply hasn't been getting through to the forward line.
Paulie Joyce gets his second point of the game. The Galway supporters, I'm sure, are just amazed at what's happening on the pitch. This was not supposed to happen. And Galway show their true spirit and character. Sean O'Donnell. Seamus Moynihan. Fouled.
by Paul Clancy and Derek Savage between them. Daro Kaneda, Aidan McGarrett, the ball in front of the forward every time. Ray Silk wins this one admirably, and the captain of 98 did very well. John Dibbley seeking out Neil Finnegan. Mike Hassett, a little bit too strong, and Corey Joyce nips in. And the jersey pulled by Dan O'Shea could well merit a yellow card. First of the game. And a chance here now for Galway to reduce that deficit. Well, there's one thing for sure, John O'Mahony is a marvellous motivator, and those sort of skills will be tested, I'm sure, at half-time, because Galway need to respond to what's happening on the field.
Very much so. I say the paint on the walls will blister in there at half-time when he gets them.
Neil Finnegan for perhaps Galway's third point of the game. And John O'Mahony will be encouraged by the scoreboard, which looks a lot better now and healthier from the Galway viewpoint.
Yes, but none of the forwards have scored from play. And secondly, one of the things, this type of scenario unfolded this year already between Kerry and Cork, and Kerry went to sleep in the second half. It'll be interesting to see how things pan out.
And the Galway supporters, who seem to be quite muted up to now, are now responding to their heroes. Here's Derek Savage on the run, takes it for his second ever point in Croke Park. Despite playing minor and under 21, and indeed Galway's successful campaign in 98, his first point was in the semi-final, and today in the All-Ireland football final he gets his second point ever in Croke Park. The scoreboard looks a lot better already. Great ball inside from Porrick Joyce, and certainly Savage showed character and determination. A little bit of pushing by Galway gives the initiative to Kerry. Mike Frank Russell. Aidan McGarrett seems to play out here in the wing a lot better, given that little bit of freedom. Player of rich talent. Little bit of a push. Some would say a shoulder. Referee was right beside it from Declan Meehan and didn't blow the whistle. Sean O'Donnell comes down towards Ray Silk. Seem to have been charging with the ball, and that's going to be a free against Ray Silk, and a chance for Kerry to increase their lead. And the introduction of Kevin Walsh at such an early stage reflects the concern in the Kerry cap, in the Galway cap. Dara O'Kaneda finds the target for his second point of the final. Five points between the teams. 5 minutes to go to the halftime whistle.
Just one thing that's noticeable at the moment, I think Porrick Joyce has come out centre half forward, Paul Clancy has gone in full forward, and the goal with full forward line really has only Derek Savage inside the 20-metre line.
I think it's a tactic that they have to employ to try and gain some possession. Declan Meehan, Kevin Walsh, already exerting an influence at midfield. Paul Clancy beating Seamus Moynihan, wants to use Finnegan. Lovely little turn, cutting inside. Paul Clancy is available. If he can get it into Finnegan with great ball control, but literally taken off his foot by Seamus Moynihan. And Galway win it back through great courage and determination. Tommy Joyce gets his first point in an All-Ireland final. older brother of Captain Porrick. Often his role is undervalued. But this was a great run by Finnegan. But just watch the skill of Finnegan, then literally taken away from him by Seamus Moynihan. What determination.
Yes, but he certainly won't thank his half-back there. I think it was either O'Sullivan or Fitzmaurice for actually losing that ball.
4 points between the teams. Sean O'Dwyer. Liam Hassett challenging. Paulie Joyce making himself once more available. Here's Michael Dunlap. And that's going to be another free. But every time Michael Dunlap gets the ball, there's two, possibly three Kerry lads. They're well aware of the danger that he can create.
Yes, they are actually colliding with him every time he gets the ball. They're really kind of, you know, applying huge physical pressure on him. That's the first time he's been involved in the game, probably in the last 10 or 15 minutes. He was somewhat subdued by Tomás O'Shea and has been on the fringe of the game too much. But when he's in it, Galway are in business.
Borick Joyce completes his hat-trick of points. And despite the rather unusual performance from Galway, in the sense that we're so used to this wonderful flair, they're still only 3 points behind. And anything is possible in an All-Ireland final. But certainly the introduction of Kevin Walsh has helped matters around that crucial centre field area. Noel Kennelly. Dara Kaneda looks so elusive and so fast. Great ball in towards John Crowley. Thought about having a go again. Here's Mike Frank Russell. This time Tomás Meehan is with him. Tomás O'Shea comes up from right half back. Older brother Dara. Dara tells Kennelly, send that over the bar. And Noel Kennelly obliges. Five of the six Kerry forwards have now scored 2 points each. The exception is Aidan McGarrett, giving you a total of 10 points. Some performance by the Kerry attack. Good passing. And amazing the order came from Dara O'Shea. Galway continue to chase this game. Tom O'Sullivan meets a brick wall that's painted maroon and white. Declan Meehan, now back in his favourite position of right half back, combining with Tommy Joyce. And away goes Meehan, and one of these surging runs up the wing, chased by Noel Kennelly. Needs support now, but it's a terrible pass. And you don't give any sort of loose passes when a chap called Seamus Moynihan is hanging around. Noel Kennelly, waiting for the pass from Liam Hassett, gives it instead to Donald Daly. In towards Mike Frank Russell, in a one against one from Mitchie Fahey. And Mike Frank sends it over the bar. The umpire at one end, yes, they have seemingly agreed. It is a great point by Mike Frank Russell. And Richie Fahey there was left floundering.
Left floundering, but I certainly thought from this angle here that we're looking at a mark because the ball had tailed off wide.
This is the ball inside to Mike Frank Russell. Richie Fahey tried to prevent the score. And one umpire seemed to question it. The other one just raised the white flag immediately. So I'm sure that'll be a talking point if Galway can reduce Kerry's lead. Noel Kennelly. Thomas Sullivan. Donald Daly is available again. The pass goes astray. And that was an unforced error.
Yeah, but credit the Galway, young Tommy Joyce in particular, putting a lot of pressure there on Donald Daly and forcing that error.
Borick Joyce. Derek Savage gets away from his marker. There's a chance here. Savage decides to take it himself and sends it over the bar. He had an option just for the slightest of moments. It was a fleeting moment. And Savage, that's why he's scratching the head. But I think overall he took the right option.
Took the right option, although there was a tremendous run there from Paul Clancy. Had he got the ball, he possibly had a goal on. But certainly it was the percentage thing. Took the right option, and now we have only 3 points.
Here's the run by Derek Savage. Thought about the pass there to Paul Clancy. Dunlan was also inside, but I think overall that Savage made the right choice.
John O'Mahony, as always, looking at the stopwatch. 14, almost 15 minutes, rather 10 minutes, I should say, played in the second half. Eamon Fitzmaurice. Declan Meehan. The brother, Tomás. Richie Fahey, giving it to John Dively. Gives it long. Neil Finnegan was tripped by Mike Hassett, and that's going to be a free. I think it was a straight pursuit for the ball, which was one of those 50-50s which favoured the Galway man. Kerry may just be thinking about introducing the one and only Morris Fitzgerald, as Neil Finnegan sets himself up for this point scoring opportunity.
Yes, just going back to the point, actually, there was a little bit of scent there by Mick Hassett, so he's brought the ball in into scorable position. Or
Finnegan chips it. And over the bar. Seemed to judge it just perfectly. And Galway are only 2 points behind. Despite, by their standards, a rather poor performance. But they seem now to be much more focused.
Much more focused, much more confident, and working a lot harder than they were in the first half.
That should be a Galway ball. And John Dibbles. Another free for Galway. John Dively, obviously suffering from that last collision. And this is his direct opponent, Dara Canada. Dennis O'Dwyer is being introduced by Kerry. And obviously, Dennis played in the semi-final against Armagh, lost out to Liam Hassett, and it looks like Noel Kennelly is the player that's departing. So a Waterville man for a Listowel Limits star. John Donlan hits it with great power. Against Sligo, and also scored. Older brother of Michael reduces Kerry's advantage to just 1 point again.
Yes, indeed, he's very little speed, but he's a super kicker of the ball up either foot. And in that case there, you see the ball up the right foot from about 50 yards straight over the bar.
Left in the All-Ireland final, and a great run by Sean O'Dwyer. The first time he's gotten a break to make this sort of surging run. Just as he was about to be challenged, he picked the ball straight into Declan O'Keefe. But they need, Galway need Sean O'Dwyer and Michael Donlan making those sort of penetrating runs. Morris Fitzgerald can't hold it. Sean O'Donnell licking it out. Over this side is Declan Meehan. Gets the return from Paul Clancy. Derek Savage. Mike McCarthy. Very good defender. Corey Joyce now takes on the challenge. Eamon Fitzmaurice. And Mike Frank Russell. Corey Joyce looking for somebody free. Neil Finnegan. Galway play keep ball, but they're going around in circles, really. They're finding it difficult to break down this Kerry defence, and for taking too many steps and charging with the ball, Kevin Walsh is punished, and it's going to be a free for Kerry. But good defending, it must be said, by the Kingdom.
Yeah, but certainly to my mind at the moment, Galway have come into it in a very, very meaningful way. They're working so hard, they're getting around them in numbers, possibly a little unlucky on Kevin Walsh in that case.
Eamon Fitzmaurice feeds Tomás O'Shea. Donald Daly
Gary Fahey is back there. Uses the option of Tomás Meehan. Dennis Dwyer gets his first touch. That O'Shea. Plenty of Kerry players available. Back to O'Shea once more. Daro Kaneda manages to almost stay inside the playing arena. Gary Fahey, challenge was illegal and is also going to be shown a yellow card. There are now six players on Croke Park with yellow cards.
Yeah, well, it must be said it's a very, very clean game. But one of the things that is noticeable at the moment, a lot of the Kerry players are struggling to stay with the tempo and the pace of the game. The movement up front has stopped, the winning of the ball around the middle of the field has stopped, and Galway certainly seem to have it with them at the moment to actually draw a level with Kerry.
Maurice Fitzgerald. Just a few metres into the sideline. And that goes wide. Kerry's eighth wide of the match. It's going to be a question of fitness and focus, determination, passion, all of the ingredients that makes All-Ireland champions.
And indeed you can add into that, Marty, a lucky break, because a lucky break at either state or either side could decide this this All-Ireland final.
Adam McGarrett. Donald Daly made himself immediately available. Outside him, Liam Hassett working tirelessly. Nice flick back to Donald Daly. Lovely skill by the Killorgan man. Galway have it once more. Declan Meehan looks at the options out the left wing, but there's nobody there. He has to go down here in front of us. Mike McCarthy again battling with Derek Savage. Nice footwork, and Galway have control here. What about giving it to Declan Meehan? I think he was lucky. Sean O'Donnell. Neil Finnegan. John Donlan waits for the high ball in around the house. And here comes the delivery. And John Donlan almost has it. Brother Michael is there with him as well. Derek Savage wants it in the middle. Donlan turns and floats it to the right and wide. The option there was definitely Derek Savage.
Oh yeah, there was a definite score on there, but an awful lot of the Kerry players at the moment look weary. They're simply hanging on. Galway, if they got a score, could go on to win this game.
Just over 10 minutes left. Or rather 5 minutes left, I beg your pardon. The tension around Croke Park is quite tangible. The crowd now get behind both teams. The clock ticks down, 4.5 minutes. Referee has blown his whistle for a foul on Paul Clancy. And here's a chance for Galway to level the match.
That's an interesting decision actually, because the referee seemed to blow his whistle when the ball was out at about 50 metres. Mick McCarthy's going in and argued it. The referee's brought it into the 20-metre line.
It is a rather silly thing to do by Mick McCarthy, because now this is a much easier opportunity for Pádraig Joyce. This is the first and only time if Pádraig Joyce puts this over the bar that the sides have been level. Joyce hits it over the bar. It's been a long journey for Galway. They have struggled right through this All-Ireland final, but their sheer determination and passion. Look at Pádraig Joyce. They really want to win it. And all of Croke Park is now a sea of maroon and white.
Indeed, they seem to have the greater belief at the moment than Kerry. They seem to have the greater energy than Kerry, and it's anybody's game.
3 minutes left. Here comes Michael Donlan. Kerry well aware of the danger that this man can create. He gets away for the first time, and Declan O'Keefe easily gathers.
Mike Hassett. Brought down by John Donlan. I'm sure there's going to be a free for Kerry. The referee still blows his whistle. I don't think even Porrig Joyce could hear him, but eventually he gains an extra few metres. So the free is for Mike Hassett and for Kerry. John O'Mahony checks his watch. Just over 2.5 minutes left in this All-Ireland final in terms of actual playing time. There have been no major injuries, no major delays. Are we heading for a draw in the All-Ireland football final? Sean Oak to prayer. Kevin Walsh. Richie Fay. Derek Savage. And it's a free for Galway. Paul Clancy gives it in towards Derek Savage. Mike McCarthy trying to stop him from having a shot. Savage holds possession. Here comes Porrig Joyce on the overlap. Savage sends it in. And Declan O'Keefe saves at the near post.
And Porrig Joyce is raging because Porrig Joyce was in a much better position that time to be given the return pass.
Kerry struggling at this moment to hold on. Sean Oak de Clare will not be pleased with that particular delivery. And Galway almost win it back just for a moment. And it's going to be a free for Kerry. It is some comeback by Galway. Look at those faces. They can hardly look. They can hardly watch the final moments of this All-Ireland final. Can Kerry go forward with one late score? John Dively, heavily challenged and fouled by Maurice Fitzgerald. And it's a free for Galway. 69 and a half minutes played.
Who wouldn't want to manage Galway? I mean, anybody in this country certainly would love to manage Galway. I mean, they've always produced great natural footballers, great skillful players. That's what I like about Galway. They play the ball, they're a skillful side, and I like to see skillful teams winning All Irelands, and Galway are one of those. Galway are an exceptional crowd. They have great following, of course. And I mean, this is a stronghold of Gaelic games. Any county that can produce two teams capable of winning All Irelands in hurling or football, that proves you one thing. There's a big backup there, and they have great support as well.
The Owl Sheebean, Moat, County Westmeath, consists of a very spacious and luxurious bar, with food served daily, including special children's menus. The function room caters for bus tours, meetings and large functions. The Owl Sheebean and Silver's Nightclub, Moat, County Westmeath.
Peacock's Hotel and Complex, surrounded by beautiful lakes located at Mam Cross, is an ideal base from which to explore Connemara. The complex, which includes a luxury hotel, restaurant and bar, large banqueting room, is ideal for every occasion. And of course, the Quiet Man Cottage, a traditional thatched Irish cottage made famous by the film of the same name. Peacock's Hotel and Complex.
Corley's Quality Foods supplies the fruit and veg ready prepared fresh foods. Corley's, overall winner for excellence in marketing, awarded by the Institute of Marketing in 1999. John Corley and Company, at Carrow Brown, Castlegar, Galway.
O'Toole's Super Value Palace Restaurant and Department Store, owned by Joseph and Helen O'Toole, has provided the people of Tuam and surrounding areas with the most modern and up-to-date shopping complex. Having won several awards, the store recently won both the regional and the Connacht final in the Cuisine de France Bakery of the Year awards in their category. Joseph O'Toole is a staunch supporter of Galway football since his days as a student in St. Jarlath College in Tuam.
The Nestor brothers, John and Tom, opened their first store in Father Griffin Road over 12 years ago and now operate three stores under the Londis brand in Father Griffin Road, Oranmore and at Ballyban Shopping Centre. The success of their businesses is based on giving the customer choice of goods at the right price together with personal touch, which is evident in each store. Their success is down to the belief that there is no success without teamwork and dedication, the same as in sport.
John Joe Hollerton and Kilbride Sand and Gravel, specialists in all weathering of Irish sports grounds, promoting better grass growth and drainage. The system is being used all over Connacht and availed of by the Galway Football Board in their new training facility. To find out more, call Kilbride Sand and All Weathering, the winning combination. All Vargam move, Shippa Gross Air Agus Nooch Dawn, Gaka Willuit Nor and Vian Sherwit, Tomas Branagh Chodanta, a Frastel of Winter and the Caharon Rue, Le Brescius Lach Heard Blien.
...2001 saw the introduction of a new format for the Football Championship, with the old knockout system being replaced by the All-Ireland Series. In addition to having lost the 2000 All-Ireland Final, Galway also lost the 2001 League Final to Mayo. The team received a timely boost with the return of Tomás Mannion, Kevin Walsh and Jarrod Fallon from injury.
When we were training, after training, we got ham sandwiches, we got bottles of milk and biscuits, you know. And these were the things that we should have been kept away from. I think at that time, lucky enough, a lot of guys were doing a lot of physical work. And they were able to work it off and so on and so forth. But nowadays, I was going to say they're really pampered, but I think that would be unfair. But they're very well looked after. One thing about the training is it's so intense now. They train like professional athletes that I don't think they enjoy the training. We enjoy the training very much. I don't think they enjoy it. It's too intense anymore.
Alan Kearns, the scorer. That's Jack Allen getting it forward. They're trying to work it into a scoring situation. Tommy Joyce beating it, he puts it over the bar. It's another score for Galway. Happy Galway fans. Alice Farris, Jaff Allen. Jaff, a familiar jinx, switch of direction. Donlan coming onto it. Good move, great kick. And it's over the bar. That's a super point by Michael Donlan. He's back. Galway winning most of that ball in midfield. That was McGrain's pass. In the end, it's the claw for Galway. Cross towards Jaff Fallon. Trying to hoof it inside for Michael Donlan to run onto. What an athlete. What a footballer. What a point. Second point by Michael Donlan. Here's Clancy once again. The man who ballooned that one wide just moments ago. This time, sensibly playing it back to Kearns. Route to goal was blocked in any case. What a look. Kind of closed down for Joyce. Good ball inside to Tommy Joyce. And that shot has gone over the bar. Good combined play. There was cohesion about the attack that time. Paulie Joyce used his head, played it inside to Tommy. Here's Joe Bergen. Players coming to him, making the pass a little easier. Steady ambitiously hits it into space. But there's two against one there, and Galway managed to get the ball back somehow. And it's the player who loves to attack. Back to Adam Kearns. This is the player. Just lost his control there. Clancy has it, and that's over the bar. Paul Clancy's first point. McGeaney, one of many left-footed kickers playing in this match. It's a terrible goal. Joyce, another one. Inside here, well, to Jaff Fallon. And finally, the left boot of Jaff Fallon is on target. And that is his first point. The man who appropriately plays for Tuam Stars, and a star he is, and now there are 7 points between these teams. Oh, that's a great blocked out. It's Michael Donlan. He blocked the clearance by Justin McNulty. Still Michael Donlan. Laying it on here. Can there be a winner? Clancy has kicked. They look at it, and it's over the bar. Paul Clancy, the substitute.
I always had a great interest in Michael, to tell you nothing but the truth. And I watched his progress all along the line, and certainly it was great to see him playing well. I sometimes think he was born to play football, that guy. Lads like Gary Fahey, Kevin Welsh, Jarrod Fallon, now just to mention a few, other lads that have come along like Paul Clancy and them. You wouldn't meet nicer fellas in the whole world.
Goalkeeper playing in his 20th championship match. Galway applying the pressure again. Tommy Joyce, this is better. That's a goal. Tommy Joyce, Kieran Aaron, getting his first point of this match. Here's Michael Donnelly. Great ball. Great positioning taken up by Paul Joyce. Taking on Canty, the young fullback. Going this way, going back. In the end, point. It's the third of the match for Galway, and the second for forward choice. They have the forwards, there's no doubt in the world about that. Cork really struggled big time in midfield last Sunday against Kerry in the Munster final. They're struggling again here. Bergen towards Joyce. Runs outside there to Ja Fallon. Quick look up at the target. Same result. They're making their period of supremacy pay, and they lead 6 points to no score. Joe Kavanagh. Can the big man get it this time? It breaks, and again there's support around there, but it falls to Clifford. Inside for Pillon. Finally get their first score, and it's a big one from Finnan Murray. It is his seventh goal in championship football. They come again. Joe Bergen racing through. O'Donovan's after him. Might have just caught him there with a challenge to effectively put him off his stride. Lynch. Oh, they were waiting at it, and here comes the player. He might be in for a goal here. Yes! 21 minutes gone. Comes up for his second ever goal in championship football. He kept it on the ground and drove it in low past Kevin O'Dwyer, but it was all the product of very poor defending. And O'Dwyer said, thank you very much indeed. Alan Kearns comes down once again here towards Matthew Clancy. Back to Derek Savage. Good ball inside to Paul Clancy. Winding himself up to hit a point, and it's a really good one. They were trying to box it back that time, when it comes to Joyce, released instead here to the number 22, Matthew Clancy, and he kicks, and it's over the bar. Larry Jenkins realizes that it's a very perilous situation now for Cork. And here's Joe Bergen, sending it out decently there to Declan Meehan. Savage, Galway with the last attack, and that's a beauty. It's over the bar from Matthew Clancy. It's a second goal for him. It's Galway surely now in the quarterfinals of the All Ireland.
I firmly believe that a point comes in every match where a question is asked of all the players in the field, especially the two teams, of who's going to win the game. It can come at different points in the game. It might come early in the second half, it could come at the midway through the second half. And that question is asked. And the team, as a team, have to answer it at that stage, that we are going to go on and win this game. And I feel that on some occasions, maybe we hadn't got that right either. That when the question was asked, that even though everybody, I believe, wanted to win it, but you need great mental toughness to go on and win the game. And even though you can put it down to bad luck in some of the games, you couldn't really say that we had bad luck in every one of the games that we played in Croke Park over those number of years.
Joe Bergen. Giving that ball in. It's a good ball in front of Derek Savage. Suits the corner forward. And Savage responds equally for the point against Cork. Dropping this one in. Corey Joyce knocks it down to Savage. And with the outside of the boot, puts it over the bar. Derek Savage. Martin Donovan and Corey Joyce combining. Back to the midfielder. Dunmore McHales. It's a conflict over the bar. Derek Savage looking around, has the time actually to look around and see who's making a run. Playing it very tight. Corey Joyce back to Kevin Walsh, and that is over the bar. Anxious to prove a point, beginning to show the old style that we've become accustomed to when we saw Kevin Walsh playing in midfield. Once again, they win possession in that crucial area of midfield. Corey Joyce turned it to Joe Bergen with depth, with flick, That's over the bar for another point. And the free, quickly taken by Nigel Dineen, sent in by Frankie Dolan. That's a sweet point. For those who mightn't be aware, Frankie Dolan is a cousin of Desi Dolan, who plays in the same position for Westmeath. We'll see him in action tomorrow, live here on the Sunday game, as Galway responds. And that is a very good score. Michael Donlan's second point. Matthew Clancy in towards Joe Bergen, gets a boot to it, swings it across. Here comes Sean O'Dupre, trying to get it over the bar, and that's exactly what he does. First point for Sean O'Dupre. Great football by Galway. Frankie Dolan, Conor Kennelly, Jerry Lohan, Jonathan Dunning is at the end of it, hits it. Oh, great goal. They finally found a pathway through this Galway defence. Not with the Route 1 strategy, long ball. This was a beautifully worked score, which showed the skills of the Roscommon forwards in terms of a short passing game. Here's a chance. Alan Kearns. He miscued it, and the referee, meanwhile, has blown his whistle. Indicating a free to Galway, as the fourth official has indicated to us here that there are 3 minutes extra time to be added on. The referee has given a free to Galway. Watch what happened just a few moments ago. Nathan Pull there on the Derek Savage, the number 15, no advantage given, so it's a free for Roy Joyce. There down injured is Paul Noon, seemed to hurt himself in that sequence of play. Roy Joyce about to, I'm sure, tap this over the bar.
The financial success following the 98 win prompted the football board to look to the future. They decided to purchase and develop a new training ground at Clare Galway.
This field became available. Whilst we didn't have the money at the time, I felt in 1997 with the committee that it would be a good idea if we had a shot at buying it. We actually bought the field of Joe Kine for £100,000 at the time. So I got on to friends out in Dublin that actually ran, they were called the Dublin Kildare Finance Committee, and they gave us the down deposit for it, which was terribly, terribly important. At the time, I expect that this is going to be the making of Galway football for all our different county teams. We think it's a very important facility, and I would like to thank the board that helped us to, that had the courage to come along with me and buy it as well. But I have to say, I'm lucky with the board we have. They're foreseeing, and that's very important.
A major underage coaching scheme for the promotion of football throughout the county was also introduced.
Bobby Jones, you know, won the Grand National that year, and there was great hype and all that carry on, and I was on to the Burks in England, and they are marvellous followers of GAA, no better than Montpellier. And they decided that they would help with this scheme, this underage scheme. They felt that this would be a good name for it, call it the Bobby Joe scheme, because he was a winner too. It has certainly grown enormously, and Liam Salmon has taken it over as leader of it here in Galway.
We have to start winning underage titles again. Look at our present team. They've all come from successful teams, whether it was St. Gerald's All-Ireland winning teams, or whether it was back in 86 where Kevin Welch and Tomás Mannion were playing on an All-Ireland winning team. You know, so that this is what we need. We need to start winning at underage again.
Keeps it going, partly blocked there by Bergen. Kicked in the end by McBride and put over the bar. Johnny McBride from Loop, getting another Derry score. Michael Donnellan trying to get a flick on it. Here's Declan Meehan. Score of that wonder goal in last year's replayed All-Ireland final as Michael Donnellan kicks high. The umpires look at it and decide that it's gone over the bar. Michael Donnellan. A familiar burst there by Toho, but he's left it behind, and Kevin Walsh fists it out here as far as Michael Donnellan. In pursuit over there was Kieran McNally. Galway still retaining possession. Kearns inside towards Savage, Derek Savage trying to make sure of this time, and he does. It's over the bar. Hit into Kevin Walsh. Powerful footballer, and that is a fine kick. It's over the bar. Both midfielders now for Galway have scored, and the teams are level for the first time. It's Paul McFlynn there, outnumbered, 3-1. Bergen playing it forward to Tommy Joyce. Here's an opportunity to tie it up. His marker throughout the game has been Gareth Bradley. The kick is by Joe Bergen, and now it is level. Joe Bergen's first point, they're happy. Gary Fahey. Here comes the player. Good pace this time, Kearns. Bergen playing it inside here. Dangerously inside for Derek Savage. He's a very accurate striker of a ball. Galway opted to try and fist it away from him. Johnny McBride looking for support. Dermot Dugan is there. Looking around, summing up his options. It's Gary Coleman. Inside towards Enda Muldooney's got it this time, and it's a goal! It was the first time he managed to beat Gary Fahey in the air. A nice ball down there, a great catch. And once he turned in, he was so, so dangerous. And that's another goal credited to Enda Muldoon. Here comes Kevin Walsh, leaving it off inside here. Joyce striking it, and he has... In fact, it's Savage who got it, and it's a third point now for Derek Savage. Declan Meehan now. Kevin Walsh calling for it. Promising build-up once again by the tribesmen. Again, another good run through here. Tommy Joyce laying it back. A real hit and hope one by Clancy. Opportunities here for Sean on the player. He's put it over the bar. Always good for a score. On Far on Garurua. The player narrows the gap. Coleman turning around. But they're not making a lot of headway. Doherty taking it back. Now the Derry men are trying to get out. And we're looking for a free that time. Gilligan kicking again, it drops short. Kane has it. Galway can rebuild and they can start all over again. They're looking for the equaliser. It's Declan Meehan being roared on by the thousands of Galway fans who are here. Nicely inside to Savage. Sean Marty Lockhart trying to force him wide. He skips past that challenge. Into the clear comes Clancy. What a finish by Galway! What a movement! Derry might have scored at the other end. Instead, it's Galway who make it 112-110. And they lead for the second time in this match.
Well, what a bit of play from Derek Savage. Once again, held the ball up very cleverly. Gave a great pass in to Clancy coming through. And young Clancy, the son of Kevin, drove it to the roof of the net. Wonderful score.
McCloy seemed to box it away off the Galway player. What bad marking this time. In comes Paul Clancy, and he very sensibly fists it and very wisely puts it over the bar. It's Paul Clancy who scores this one. The Clancy clan have done the business. Sean O'Donnell breaks it down for a Derry player to come through and come onto. Muldoon waiting. A late chance, and that's gone over the bar. And I think it may well be Dermot Heaney. It is. It's his first point since coming off the bench. So now the margin is 3. Alan Kane's kick. Derry have to win it back, and do. Gary Coleman. The referee has blown the whistle. It's all over. And Galway are in the All-Ireland final once again. 2 years in a row. It's been a great comeback, winning in the end by 3 points, but trailing by 5 at one stage of the second half. That's a turnaround of 8 points. It does Galway great credit to fight back, to show their strength.
I suppose, looking back on it, it was a great move, but at the time, I suppose John Dibley got injured and we were looking for number 6, and I wasn't too happy in that full back line, so I suppose I was tried at number 6 and it worked out well, you know.
we made our executive train available. Now this is a luxury train which has usually used for corporate occasions, and we made it available on the Saturday, and I think while I don't want to claim credit, I think the journey up on Saturday was one of the most calming journeys I've ever seen of any group. The team were very relaxed in lounge seating on the train, and they certainly seemed to be in the right frame of mind for Sunday.
It helps from his point of view to make sure that the team are tucked away carefully. They have their own private dining room, they have their own section of bedrooms, and they're away from everybody, and that's exactly what he wants. I think the added attraction is our magnificent leisure centre here. Our 18-hole golf course, which was designed by another great Galway man, Christy O'Connor, and our new executive 18-hole golf course that just opened last July here. All this is a huge contribution to what sporting people want, which makes the whole thing work for them. They're not just tucked away in a hotel. They can go over to the swimming pool, they can use the fitness centre, and they can go on to the driving range. And we have our own City West helicopters here that will take them in and out to the city if they wish, or anywhere else for that matter.
Early on, Darren Fay coping well. Cormac Sullivan out towards Evan Kelly. Real danger man, pacey performer. Sean O'Dwyer chasing after him. Nicely inside here towards Ellie Murphy. And there's the first foul by Gary Fahey there, as Graham Gardy was making his way through, injuring his left shoulder. A tipping for Gary Fahey. Free to Meath. Really explosive start.
Yes, indeed, Jeremy. On the other side of the field, I know there's a couple of changes in the marking systems. First of all, I think the full form is very excited.
That's kicked over there. Roy McGee. First point of the match. Richie Keeley trying to win it there against the other number 12, Joe Bergen. McDermott firing it down towards Ollie Murphy, holding on to him well. Murphy so dangerous, and that is one of the reasons why he's put it over the bar. Ollie Murphy's first point of the day, and Joe Bergen. Joe, whose uncle Jack from Tipperary, of course, was one of the selectors for Tip 2 weeks ago in the hurling final. Nicely in here to Graham Garrity, getting there ahead of Gary Fahey. Held up beautifully, John McDermott, and he has put it over the bar. Red Bull is taking the line over the bar. Michael Riley trying to get that ball away from danger. Colin Joyce winning it back. Here's Jar Fallon. On the left ball, he puts it beautifully over the bar. Jar at his very best. Enthusiastic Galway followers have seen their side draw level once again.
Indeed, last year the Galway followers bemoaned the fact that Jal wasn't there when they played Kerry, but that's a confidence-boosting score from him. Again, lovely way he gets onto the left foot and puts it delightfully over the back from about 45 yards.
Nestor's after him. Several players after him. Back towards Savage, tight angle, inside towards Colin Joyce, getting turned, plays it back well, and it's kicked over by Joe Bergen. Just a forward of a while ago, but they've taken the lead for the first time.
That's a beautiful piece of a combined favour to go with forward on Savage, eventually been finished off by Bergen. Wonderful piece of football. And again, he dropped a couple of balls earlier back to his confidence, but Jai gets the ball across here. Sean Hope coming forward which he normally does, lets the ball back, and eventually Derek Savage puts it to Bergen and puts it over.
John McDermott and Kevin Walsh. Walsh just getting a touch to it. Richie Keeley trying to win it there against the other number 12, Joe Bergen. McDermott firing it down towards Ollie Murphy, holding on to it well. Murphy so dangerous, and that is one of the reasons why he's put it over the bar. Ollie Murphy's first point of the day, and the teams are level for the third time. So still 4-3.
You know, one of the things we wondered about early on, how well were the Meath defence doing the Galway attack? Galway attack's getting loads of possession in there, but they're not converting.
Here's Paul Kenty now, picking on Hank Traynor, showing how it should be done. Paul Clancy's first, is a quality footballer. This was wonderful skill here by Clancy. Had strength, had resolve, and had accuracy. This is Berger. Galway retained possession. Michael Donovan fouled. It may be scrappy, but every time you get a chance like this one here to engineer a scoring opportunity, you've got to try and take it. Poor choice, turning into a challenge. Waiting for Bergen, should be a point here. He's put it over the bar. Joe Bergen second. They had to graft and they had to work for that, but there was good support play by Joe Bergen. He's had two shots at the target, he scored twice, and Galway are leading in this match in front of an attendance of over 70,000.
Yeah, good pass that time from Colin Joyce, and Joe Bergen saw the gap over the middle in front of him, had the confidence to go on and finish in front of him.
Bergen again jumping here with Nigel Crawford. Tomas Mannion's coming to support, getting away from Ray McGee. Mannion, such a quality footballer. Missed most of last season, he's fouled, taken down, 3-in. Great opportunity for the Galway to get themselves another point. And it's all down to the genius of Tomas Mannion and his sheer willingness to take it forward at every opportunity. And Pori Joyce has now got the responsibility. About 30 metres out. He should get this one. This to put 2 points between the teams. He's got it absolutely right. It's his first point of the match, and it's now Galway 6, Meath 4. John O'Mahony, I'm sure, quietly pleased alongside Pete Warren and Stephen Joyce over there. Pete on the right. Selectors, when they last won the title, are they to do it again? Early stages. We've got about 3 minutes or thereabouts to half time, and there'll be one extra minute to be played. Evan Kelly, second time of asking, feeding it inside towards Nigel Crawford, looking for space. Galway funneling back men. Ray McGee kicking, and Ray McGee has driven it high and over the bar. Declan Meehan, got to skip away from the attentions over there of Richie Keeley. Donald Curtis breaking it down. Ja Fallon trying to keep possession. It's with Bergen. That's a decent ball. In for Corey Joyce, getting inside Darren Fay. Here's a good chance, and he has put it over the bar. Puts his hands to his head straight away, because he knows it should have been under.
That's a huge blow to Meath, actually, if Ollie Murphy's gone off. He must have injured something very badly if he's been forced to take a complete break from the game.
He has to be injured. You wouldn't take him off at an All-Ireland final. He's such a valuable forward. So too is Derek Savage. Good work by Mark O'Reilly. Donald playing it inside for Pollock Joyce. Good steadying effect here by Joyce. He's at his most explosive. He has kicked a fourth point. Kevin Walsh of Galway, holding up the play. Ja Fallon. Back to Walsh. Good ball to Corey Joyce. It's a clever ball. It was right in front of him, giving a decent chance. This on his right side. And he has kicked this one. And he's put it over. 6 points for Joyce. Showing that he's equally accomplished on his right-hand side Well, I think it was the quality of the passing that made it all happen.
Yes, a quick, crisp pass from Kevin Walsh into Corey Joyce, who incidentally has been marked by Mark Riley, which surprises me. Darren played a good game on him in the first half, but this time with his right foot, scores a very good point. He's having a marvellous game in the second half from play.
He's had 11 shots at the target, he's scored 6 times. Evan Kelly for a Meath side with only 6 points to their credit following their fascinating win in the semi-final against the defending champions Kerry. Cormac Murphy up among the attackers, back once again towards Paddy Reynolds inside here. Nigel Crawford, great block down. Still the opportunities for Trevor Giles, and Giles has kicked it wide. And I think an awful lot of Galway followers here right now, with just over 16 minutes to play, are probably thinking Meath don't have it in them this afternoon. This was Nigel Crawford, and that was where it was blocked down really well, and Kevin Walsh back there helping out.
Yes, but there are so many Meath players off colour today. It's amazing that for an All-Ireland final, I think too many of them maybe believe that Hygham have spoken about, you know, arising from the victory against Kerry.
Cormac Murphy challenging for this one. It reaches Paddy Reynolds. Nicely taken down by Shadow Bacroix. Is he to win another All-Ireland medal? Early stages yet as Kieran Fitzgerald takes it forward. Meehan coming onto it. The attack conscious number 5. Derek Savage. Plenty of players waiting for it to come their way. Corrick Joyce again on his right hand side. By Reynolds this time. By John McDonald. And over the ball. It's an excellent spell for Galway. And Corrick Joyce is coming good in the second half. A little tentative in the first. He's finding his confidence. He's finding the target. And he's found his best form. It's 12 points to 7.
Yes, a lovely piece of interplay again, and a great finish with his right foot by Corey Joyce, having a super second half.
Graham Geraghty. Remember, it's a Meath team missing the injured Ollie Murphy. Into Paddy Reynolds. Knocking it in well. And that is kicked over the bar by the substitute, John Cullinan. His first chance, his first score. It's a vital one. It means there are only 4 between them. And we've talked so often in the build-up to this, in many discussion places, everywhere and anywhere, about Meade's capacity to get goals. This man got a goal the last day. Today, it's a point. One decent chance for Sean Boylan's team. And you never know what might happen. We've seen Galway now miss 2 goals.
Yes, but the main goal of goal, so to speak, and the Meath team is on the bench at the moment and don't look to have it in them today to score a goal. But again, maybe they're famous last words.
Declan Meehan pursued by Graham Geraghty. Great pace. Lovely control. Nice action. Down to Savage. Inside to Paul Clancy. Held off the challenge well. Good pass. Paul Joyce. At the receiving end. The umpires look and decide it's another one for Corey Joyce. It's his 8th of the match. It's some display now by this wonderfully talented footballer. It's 13 points to 8. Cormac Murphy is about to be replaced, but first let's look at this again. And if you're watching it in Ayr Square or any part of Galway, you'll revel in this.
Well, he's absolutely oozing class and authority at the moment. He's had some tour de force over the last 10 minutes or so. Tremendous display. But again, I say, it's surprising that Darren Fay isn't picking him up.
While Kelly's in, Cormac Murphy is off. Wasn't necessarily Cormac Murphy's type of game. Tommy Joyce just went everywhere and anywhere, barring to the dressing rooms. It's won back by Paddy Reynolds. He'll have been disappointed enough not to have started this match. Good ball down. Here it comes again. John McDermott's around, and the referee's giving a penalty. It's a penalty to Meath. Kevin Walsh being spoken to by the referee. And Michael Collins was emphatic.
Yes, that was a very cheeky and perceptive pass by Graham Geraghty. into John McDermott that time, and probably he made the most of it in earning the penalty, but I think it was a correct decision by the referee.
The point is, Meath have so many leaders, they've only got a short amount of time to go, about 12 minutes, but they're well capable. Trevor Giles is going to kick this. Crucial. 5 points between the teams. Maximum concentration. Against him, Alan Kane. Three and a half minutes into the second half. This to give Meath some real hope. Giles has got it right. Oh, an amazing miss. They will feel it so dead. Surely after that.
Well, it sums up his day for them. Those days simply nothing goes right for you, and maybe this is one of those days for Trevor. Remember in 1996 he scored the goal against Mayo, but Donnie the same goals. This time just a little cheeky pass from Geraghty. And okay, two or three of them went around, but John certainly did a little bit of a dive there. Got the penalty but missed it, and maybe there was justice in it.
It's about this. Kane kicking deep to midfield. McDermott rising again. They feel they still have a chance. Lost by hand trainer. Here comes Paul Clancy. Nice solo, good control. It might have been a goal at the other end. It's a point for Galway. It's looking like for a day. Galway have been much the more dominant factor.
Yes, and the stretch credibility to expect Meath to play as well today as they played against Kerry the last day, but certainly none of it expected them to be as quiet and to be as off-colour as they were.
They've only scored 8 points. Missed a penalty. Declan Meehan, he's in again. De Pryor is alongside him. Wisely, I think he put it over the bar. That's his first point. But it's interesting that Cholo De Pryor was backing him up just in case a pass came his way. And a goal there, the man is going to blow the whistle. John O'Mahony about to make the late change. So Joe Bergen off. No fault of Joe Bergen's. He played really well.
Well, indeed, it's nice to see a bit of sentiment in sport, and I'm delighted John O'Mahony gave Alan Cairns a run here, because he'd been so effective for them in so many games during the summer, that it's great that he got on the field for an All-Ireland final, two of his All-Ireland medal.
Kieran Coleman is coming on as well, and Tommy Joyce going off. They haven't won. Only a matter of seconds now. Michael Donnellan breaking it down. Chinking his way in there. There's the substitute, Alan Kearns. Referee awarding the free. It's quite a tired-looking Meath team this afternoon. They've looked leaden-footed for most of the 70 minutes. Never really seemed to have it. Boris Joyce, it's only shooting practice at this stage. He has kicked 10 points in this All-Ireland football final. It is all over, and Galway are the Bank of Ireland All-Ireland football champions for 2001. A game without any goals. Galway had a couple of chances. Meath had a penalty. Meath also lost Nigel Nestor with 20 minutes of the match remaining. But in spite of all of that, there was one team really up for it today, and they were the men from the West.
We've seen all of Ireland on this campaign, and it's great to finish here on the last Sunday in September, the second last Sunday with the Sam Maguire Cup, and it's brilliant to be going back to Galway with it.
We had faith in ourselves, and now we're back in heaven where we belong, winning All-Ireland.
Now it's the turn of Gary Fahey, the Galway captain. To come and take the cup. The Sam Maguire Cup is going to Galway. It's the county's ninth All-Ireland title. They're third in the league as it were, behind Kerry and Dublin.
And so, as Galway carried the legendary Sam Maguire Cup around this wonderful edifice in 2001, the county can look forward with confidence to playing its part in many great sporting occasions here during the third millennium, just as it has carried the torch for Michael Cusack since that small gathering in John Sweeney's house in Loughrea in 1884.
Dreamt I'd wear the jersey on All-Ireland final day, stand out there in Croke Park with the mighty part to play. We'd come out of the tunnel to a great big Galway roar. We'd have our picture taken and head down to the goal. And we'd line up with the captain and march behind the band. And when they played the anthem, we'd face the flag above the stand. 'Cause me heart is in maroon and white, I'll stick with what I know. It's maroon and white forever, no matter where I go. When the ball comes towards me, I'll turn and head for goal. I'll stick it in the corner like a bullet, hard and low. And I dreamt I'd hold the medal so precious in my hand, with the people all around me and the ghosts up in the stand. And then on Monday evening, when we bring the cup back home, the bonfires will be blazing all along the road. Oh, me heart is in maroon and white, I'd stick with what I know. It's maroon and white forever, no matter where I go. Yes, maroon and white forever, it's what I always say. The maroon and white of Galway, forever and a day. Maroon and white of Galway, forever and ever.